United Nations in its resolution on universal access to health and universal health coverage points out that investment in health has been proven in some countries to yield up to 9 times that value in economic and social benefits.
That observation is helping to drive healthcare development in Jamaica. And in today's show, we'll highlight some of the strategies to achieve universal access to healthcare. Hi there, I'm Adrian Atkinson. Welcome to Jamaica Magazine. We will also be exploring measures to leverage sport for wealth creation later. See how you can help make our roads much safer by applying simple courtesies. There's still more to come, but to see it all, you'll have to stick around.
A healthy and educated people living in a clean, natural environment. Reducing crime, improving the justice system and governance, building a prosperous economy. It's not just a vision, it's reality. Learn about the plan. Join the vision.
My country, Jamaica, has a rich heritage and is very unique. If we all pull together, we can make it the place of choice to
live, work, raise families, and to do business.
For more information on Vision 2030, call the Planning Institute of Jamaica or visit vision2030.gov.jm, your parish library, school library, or the Jamaica Information Service.
Government continues to build a resilient and robust healthcare system that will allow greater accessibility and affordability of quality health services. This year's initiatives include the continued improvement of infrastructure and better prevention, treatment, and management measures. Take a look.
For this financial year, we will focus on a sustained vector control program, the adolescent health program, continuing work on the national health information system, strengthening oral health, procuring 16 additional ambulances, developing cancer care, acquisition of the linear accelerator machines. This administration will continue to build on the solid foundation that we have laid for the health sector to secure the future of this country and to make health a major player in the growth and development agenda of our country.
In line with that commitment, the Ministry of Health will begin the process of designing a 10-year development plan for the health sector this fiscal year. The ministry is also restructuring the public health services to deal with shifts in the population and the disease burden. These efforts will be supported by the continued upgrading of primary healthcare facilities.
We plan to undergo work at Greenville Health Center in Westmoreland, Comprehensive Health Center in St. Andrew, Maxfield Park Health Center, Christian Penn in St. Catherine, Runaway Bay in St. Anne will receive brand new clinics.
Improvement work will also be carried out on the Buff Bay Health Center in Portland, while the Stony Hill Health Center will be expanded. Design of a new health center for Port Maria is to be completed, and the ministry is looking at options to fund a new health center for Old Harbor in St. Catherine. At the same time, $460 million will be spent upgrading 12 secondary healthcare facilities.
Among these facilities, Mr. Speaker, will be the further expansion of the Linstead Hospital and the Princess Margaret Hospital Accident and Emergency Area.
And progress is expected on plans to build a state-of-the-art child and adolescent hospital in Western Jamaica. Meanwhile, 16 new ambulances will be bought. Illnesses such as cancer, diabetes, and hypertension continue to burden the Jamaican health sector. So this year, the ministry will continue implementation of the National Strategic and Action Plan for the prevention of non-communicable diseases.
Now, efforts to reduce premature deaths from NCDs by 25% by 2025, the ministry is designing and developing a cancer care system of excellence to be located at the St. Joseph's Hospital.
This will result in the cost of full course radiation treatment moving from $1.8 million to zero for the most vulnerable in society. The Health Ministry is also exploring the use of the human papillomavirus vaccine to significantly reduce the number of deaths and disabilities caused by cervical cancer in Jamaica. The move towards universal health coverage also continues. And as the fiscal year progresses, the Ministry of Health plans to advance its National Health Information System and e-health strategy using $30 million from the National Health Fund.
We will eventually link all our facilities so that we can have continuity of care and easily accessible patient records for more efficient and effective service.
The ministry's mission towards improved health outcomes for all Jamaicans this year is supported by increased financing.
We have doubled, Mr. Speaker, the pharmaceutical budget to $8 billion this financial year. We have significantly increased our health promotion and prevention budget from $20 million last year to $271 million this year. We have increased our equipment maintenance from $80 million last year to over $500 million this year.
The Ministry of Health, anticipating and responding to Jamaica's health needs, setting the pillars to make health a major player in the country's growth and development.
Excess salt in your diet increases blood pressure and contributes to kidney damage, gastric cancer, obesity, osteoporosis, and the worsening of asthma. Aim to have no more than 3 to 6 grams of salt, or half of 1 teaspoon per day. And children under 11 years of age should consume less than this. Get healthy, reduce the salt. A public service message from the Jamaica Information Service and the Ministry of Health.
Sport is big business, generating significant income for many countries across the globe. The government is working to attract some of that wealth to Jamaica using sport tourism. Let's take a look at this strategy and its many benefits.
Jamaica, home to world-renowned athletes, a few of the best game facilities, and award-winning rest and relaxation spots. These represent two of the country's biggest assets, sport and tourism. A marriage of the two has the potential to bring great earnings and development to the country, and government is positioning Jamaica to make the investment and reap the rewards.
Sports tourism is any visitor that comes to our country to either participate in sport or to view a sporting event.
We sometimes don't realize the impact that sport has on persons across the world. I remember once standing at Courtly, right at the porte-cochere, and there was a gentleman coming back, sweaty and hot, and I said to him, "Sir, where are you coming from?" Walking on the road, and he says, "I just fulfilled my lifelong dream." And I was like, "Really?" And he says, "Yes." He's an Australian fellow. And he said, "I just walked to Sabina Park, got the groundsman to let me in, went on the pitch, laid myself out, took pictures, and he said, from I'm a child, I'm dreaming of coming to Jamaica and having that experience."
That's a testament to the power of Brand Jamaica as a sporting destination. In 2012, the Ministry of Tourism and Entertainment established the Sports Tourism Implementation Committee. Its job is to provide the framework to sustainably develop sport tourism and to leverage local and international sport events to increase visitor arrivals. A year later, the Ministry of Sport tabled the National Sport Policy, which includes plans to develop sport tourism. The two ministries are jointly pursuing the plan, and already their efforts have led to the birth of a new initiative, Jamaica Sport. Jamaica Sport was officially launched in October 2014 to explore the commercial opportunities provided by sport tourism.
This entity, Jamaica Sport, will anchor and execute the objectives of a major events attraction program and outlines a blueprint for establishing Jamaica as a major sports tourism destination in the region.
There are four main strategic areas of focus. Working in tandem with the National Council on Sport to develop a mechanism for bidding on or hosting strategically important sport events. It also aims to develop a methodology to identify and select indigenous sport activities that can help market Jamaica as a major events attraction destination in the region. Jamaica Sport will also work with the Planning Institute of Jamaica and the Jamaica Tourist Board to develop an economic model for assessing sport events. And a partnership will be pursued with InSport Jamaica to develop athletes and nurture world-class talent as part of an athlete ambassador-type program. That program should raise the public profile of elite athletes for the country's economic benefit. Possibilities include marketing sites linked to some of Jamaica's top athletes.
Usain Bolt's house could eventually one day become such a site, you know, where people want to see where he grew up.
The potential for developing sport tourism as a viable market segment in Jamaica is tremendous. In 2013, 4,000 people visited the country, mainly for sport, and the belief is that the number could be significantly more, particularly as the country continues to bask in its dominance in track and field at successive Olympic Games and World Championships. For example, prior to the 2012 London Olympics, Jamaica experienced four consecutive years of negative growth in visitor arrivals from the United Kingdom. But in 2013, months after the Games, the country had 4.7% growth, which has continued to as recently as August 2014, when data reflected a 13% growth in arrivals from the UK.
The range of offers in Jamaica are endless, from the traditional golf, tennis, diving, track and field, and sailing, to more interesting activities such as surfing, kiteboarding, and BMX bike riding. Yes, we pretty much have it all.
Jamaica Sport represents a mix of private and public sector stakeholders. They are selling the point that Jamaica is open for business, and sport tourism is yet another product proudly representing Grand Jamaica.
You can lower your salt intake by checking the labels when buying processed and packaged foods. Compare products and choose the options lower in salt. A low salt option should have less than 120 milligrams of sodium per 100 grams of food. Reduce the salt and increase your consumption of fresh unprocessed foods. When cooking and at the table, use herbs, spices, and other seasonings to give you great flavor and taste. A public service message from the Jamaica Information Service and the Ministry of Health.
Look inside the drum. Those are the Aedes aegypti larvae, the one that causes dengue fever. If all of these larvae mature to be adults, and if the female larva bites someone with the dengue fever, it will acquire the dengue virus. And if that mosquito bite you, you will get it.
Dengue fever?
Yes. Help prevent the spread of dengue.
Clean up your home and community.
Destroy mosquito breeding sites.
Protect yourself from mosquito bites. Prevent dengue fever.
Injuries and death due to road crashes are avoidable. We can prevent these crashes and the harm they cause by using the roads with greater care. Disengage from those things that we all know can cause road crashes. More on what to do in this next feature.
Thank you.
Most of our road accident victims belong to the 20 to 39 age group. And when we lose them, families lose breadwinners and productivity levels drop significantly. But economic activity is not the only thing affected by road accidents and fatalities. Survivors have to be treated and they demand some serious medical resources. Kenny Tear of the Road Safety Unit will be joining us and he'll be helping us to crunch those figures. Calm and beautiful, isn't it? Quite the opposite of what happens in our A&E departments.
Right about that.
Well, give us a little about your experience.
Traffic collisions forces a lot of our patients, passengers, drivers to end up in hospitals. What you find happening is that these road users suffer from all different types of injuries. For example, motorcyclists. A lot of our motorcyclist fatalities are due to head injuries. No helmet. Pedal cyclists also. We find even drivers and passengers themselves having that issue of being killed as a result or injured.
When these persons go to the accident and emergency unit, and they might have a surgery, does it have any impact at all on what happens at the hospital?
Definitely. Disrupt the entire hospital system. Hospital personnel have to be called from their homes. What it does, it forces the hospital to delay cancer surgery, kidney surgery, liver surgery. And you can think about a mammoth of other issues that the hospital have to delay in order to attend to something that they never planned for.
What about resources to get persons to and from the hospital from the crash sites?
Pressure is placed on the ambulance sector of the health sector to attend to the crash site to remove persons injured or killed. Depending on the circumstances. We shouldn't have to be contending with the fact that we have to now procuring more ambulances to deal with traffic crashes. We wouldn't know the right thing, so we must do the right thing, and the stress on the medical sector is enormous.
And I'm happy you mentioned stress because I'm sure that payments, you have to make other payouts to these hospital workers.
You're going to have to work them overtime. There's a cost on the state. And we don't need that. We already have many issues to deal within the health sector and traffic crashes. This thing is about ranking number two. In some health regional authorities, it is number two, right? And if we're not careful, this thing will spiral out of control.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Hi there, I'm Simone Wolf with your JIS News of the Week. Number portability for all Jamaicans came into effect on Monday of this week, giving consumers the ability to switch from one telecommunications network to another and retain their original numbers. Science and Technology Minister Philip Paulwell said that like all new systems of this magnitude, there may be minor glitches, but said he expected any issue to be quickly addressed with minimal inconvenience to consumers. Under the Telecommunications Act Number Portability Rules 2014, providers cannot charge subscribers who wish to switch from one network to another. Labour and Social Security Minister Derek Kellyer informed Parliament this week that government would be allocating $75 million this year to help offset the economic challenges facing vulnerable Jamaicans. It replicates an allocation made last year under the Short-Term Poverty Intervention Project.
Our evaluation showed that the assistance impacted in a very significant way the economic conditions of the recipients.
Each member of parliament will be given $1 million, disbursed in two equal tranches, half in the July to September period and the remainder in December. Minister Kellyer also informed Parliament that his ministry would be going island-wide between August 10 and 28 to pre-select suitable persons for the Canadian Farmwork Programme. The ministry's recruiting teams will conduct interviews at four strategic locations, each pulling candidates from a number of parishes.
So that when the Canadian employers submit requests for workers in the various categories, a ready supply of suitable workers will be available.
Cabinet this week reported that the National Logistics Initiative Council, NLIC, had reported that Kroc Group did not provide enough due diligence information under a non-binding memorandum of understanding with the government. As a result, the council said it could not recommend that negotiations proceed at this time between the government and the group to potentially develop and fund infrastructure for the planned logistics hub. Cabinet said it had accepted NLIC's recommendation, but it also authorized the industry ministry, if it so wished, to continue discussions with Kroc to see whether additional credible due diligence information could be had. The Organization of American States has provided $15 million to fund the Peckham Community Bamboo Project as part of government's Bamboo Products Industry Project.
Those funds, which will be applied over a three-year period, will go directly towards training of at least between 50 to 80 persons in the community of Peckham. It will go towards ensuring the proper certification of the Peckham plantation to establish it as an organic plantation. It will also seek to support the establishment of the pre-processing plant through the provision of equipment and as well as retrofitting the space.
On Tuesday, the Chinese ambassador to Jamaica also contributed $1.5 million to the initiative, while the Caribbean Local Economic Development Project is providing $500,000 to train participants, and the NHT is assisting with construction of the factory and supporting plant. The trade environment has been enhanced with the signing of a memorandum of understanding that should reduce transaction costs at the ports. The trade facilitation MOU was signed by representatives of eight government ministries this week and will pave the way for a more transparent process at the ports.
Today's MOU signing signifies our continuing efforts to deepen the business environment reform process and to ensure measurable achievements in the trade facilitation outcomes and in trade performance.
And finally, wide-scale vector control activities are being carried out in Portmore to get rid of virus-carrying mosquitoes. Acting Mayor of Portmore, Councillor Leon Thomas, says the activities include $12 million in drain cleaning.
In Waterford, Westchester Division, Gregory Park, Naguhead, Greater Portmore, Brayton, all 12 division across the length and breadth of Portmore start drain cleaning.
And those were some of the stories making news this week. I'm Simone Wolf.
Bamboo Growers, companies involved in the manufacturing of bamboo products. Get registered with the Bureau of Standards Jamaica. The BSJ is a member of the International Network for Bamboo and Rattan, and the government of Jamaica wants to develop a standard-led bamboo industry that could lead to job creation and economic growth. Companies, your products could be stamped with the regionally recognized Jamaica Made Mark certification and the National Certification Mark. Get registered and receive quality training and international certification. For more information, call the Bureau's Special Projects Department at 926-3140 or visit the BSJ at 6 Winchester Road, Kingston 10.
This is where we close Jamaica Magazine for today. We're back tomorrow with more useful information. In the meantime, keep the link. Use our Facebook and Twitter pages, YouTube channel, and the JIS website to stay in touch and get the very latest government information. On behalf of the entire team here at the JIS, I'm Adrian Atkinson, reminding you to stay healthy, eat well, get adequate rest, and make every day a productive one.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.